right, guys. So today what we are going to be talking about is IFRS 16 leases. So come on in. So IFRS 16. So what is lease? So how do we define lease? So as per IFRS 16, a lease has been defined as a contract or part of a contract that conveys the right to use an underlying asset. So it is a contract or part of a contract that conveys right to use an underlying asset for a period of time in exchange for consideration. So we get the right to use an asset in exchange for consideration. So we give out some consideration. So for that, so the person, the entity which gives us the asset is called lessor. So lessor, if you want to define it properly, so this is what's the definition given by IFRS 16. So the entity that provides the right of use assets and in exchange receive consideration. For us, it is we transfer the consideration. So they are the lessor, we are the lessee. So for lessee, the definition is the entity which obtains the right to use an asset. Okay, so which obtains use of right of use assets. Okay, and then we transfer consideration in exchange for that. So what is right of use assets? So you might say, okay, right of use assets, what is right of use assets? So right of use assets is the lessee's right, lessee is the us, to use an underlying assets over the lease term. So lessee's right to use an underlying asset over the lease term. So it's an agreement where it has been specified how much consideration will be paid and then for how long will that actually last for. So it's an agreement between two parties and then it's a lease agreement just like rent. So suppose you're giving a rent rental property or whatever you have, so you're giving that rent. So you are the lessor and then the one who is receiving it is the lessee, the one who is giving it is the lessor. Okay, and then after that, so the proper definition is over here, and then the lessor gives the right to use an assets and then in exchange they receive consideration, whereas in case of lessee they receive the right of use assets and then in exchange they pay some consideration. Every month they pay some rent, just like rent. And then so how long will they use it? So that is our right of use assets. So it will be defined in the contract and then it will be over a lease term, whatever the term has been defined in the contract. Okay, so this is how we recognize a right of use assets as well in our balance sheet. So it is seen, the property that we have leased will be seen as right of use assets. So let's see some of those, like lease contract, whether it is a just a contract or it's a lease contract. So we have to identify that. So some of the contract might seem like, is it a lease or is it just a contract? So it might be very confusing. So let's look at it. Another thing that's very important in lease is that you have to identify whether the contract actually contains a lease or not. Otherwise, it might just be a contract. So what differentiates between a contract and a lease? So the main difference which lies is that there is a control, right to control the identifiable assets. Whereas in case of contract, there might not be the control. So that's the main thing that differentiates whether that contract actually contains a lease or not. Okay, so that's very important. So a contract contains a lease if it conveys the right to control the use of an identified assets. The assets that can be identified or this particular place. So you must be given a fixed particular place. So for a period of time in exchange for consideration. In exchange for consideration, so you receive the right of use assets, you pay them some consideration. So if you look at your book in TYU1, so coffee bean, I'll give you a simple example. So coffee bean enters into a contract with an airport operator, to use some place, some space in the airport to sell its goods from portable kiosk for 3 years period. Coffee Beans owns the portable kiosk, so they own the particular kiosk from where they sell the goods. So the contract stipulates the amount of space and states that the space may be located at any one of the several departure areas within the airport. So any. So the place is not fixed. So the airport operator can change the location of the space allocated to Coffee Bean. So does this thing contain a contract? So in order to be a contract, in order to be a lease, a contract should specify the right of use assets, and then it should give us identifiable assets, and there should be a mention of time period and in exchange for consideration. So in this particular question, in Coffee Bean's case, even though the question has mentioned how much consideration we are paying and then the lease term as well, but the right to control a specified asset is not there. You know why? Because it is a portable kiosk, and tomorrow if the operator sees that somebody else is paying more amount than us, then he is readily gonna substitute us. Okay, so he has a very very little cost for replacing us. So we don't have a right to control that specified area. So that's not within the control. So it is just a contract, not a lease. Okay, so that's a very important question. Important thing that we need to think about when we are looking at leases. So to determine whether that is a lease or not, we need to be very sure whether we have the right to control the identified assets or not. So in this case, what's the asset? It's the space that they are giving us in the airport. So when will we have the control of the assets? So we will have the control of the assets if the right to substantially all of the identified economic benefits. So over the period of its economic life, so substantial parties or major economic parties used by us, then it is assumed that we have the control. So another thing is that the right to direct the identified use. So you have the right to direct whether how should you use that particular asset. So you have the right. So that particular person, whoever was leasing that particular area, so if he had the right to control that area, then he could be selling something else from there, right? Not only a kiosk, he could be maybe setting up something else and then doing that. So he can direct the use of it. So can right to use assets exist if lessor puts restrictions? So sometimes, let's say you give out your particular flat that you have for rent, and then you tell the lessee, like suppose you are the lessor and you tell the lessee that you can use it properly, but don't keep explosives within this particular area, or like this area is very sensible, so please avoid this kind of items. So you can only use this kind of things. So if there is a restrictions from the lessor, then is it a control? Does the control exist over here? What is it? Does it exist? So we said that the lease, in order to be lease, it needs to have a control of the right to control the use of identified assets for a period of time in exchange for consideration. So do we have the right to control if the lessor puts on a restriction? Yes, we still do. You know why? Because that is just a change of scope, not the change in direction, because we can still direct how we use it, right? So even though we may not be able to put explosives or anything dangerous goods over there, or any gas cylinders or whatever they have said, so even though we can't put it, we can actually have other alternatives for using it, so we can direct the use of it. So yes, it is still a lease and not only a contract. Okay, that's very important. So now let's look at a few other questions. Let's solve some TYUs. So there is another interesting question in your book. So AFZ enters into a contract with Splash. So AFZ enters a contract with Splash. So if we were to write it AFZ enters a contract with Splash. So to use a specified SIP. So the contract contains a SIP 5 years. Splash has no substitution rights. So Splash has no substitution rights. During the contract period, AFG decides that what cargo will be transported, when the ship will sail, and to which ports it will sail. However, there are some restrictions specified in the contract. Those restrictions prevent AFG from carrying hazardous goods or materials as cargo, or from sailing the ship into waters where piracy is a risk. So Splash operates and maintains the ship and is responsible for safe passage of the cargo on board the ship. AFG is prohibited from hiring another operator for the ship and operating the ship itself during the term of the contract. So does this contract contain a lease? So in the question, it said that Splash has no alternative or substitution rights, right? So earlier on when we discussed the particular thing, so it is an identifiable asset and it should not be, or the lessor should not have the right to substitute it, okay? So that's very important. Otherwise, tomorrow they might say, okay, use this ship. Another day they might say, okay, use this ship. So you don't have an actual control over the asset, so you can't actually, that's not a lease, all right? So in this particular case, AFC has done a contract with Splash for a particular ship which is not replaceable, and then the ship for 5 years, right? And then in this case, so the Splash has particularly told AFC that you can't carry explosive goods within, or when you can sail from this port or this state. So they have actually specified what kind of material and which way they can actually travel in the sea. So why did Splash say that? Because they don't want to risk losing their ship. Suppose if the hazardous goods they were carrying, if AFC was carrying hazardous goods and then it was passing through a dangerous area, so there might be some pirates which might shoot the particular explosive tanks or whatever they might have. So after that, Splash might lose the whole ship. So in this case, what has Splash done is that Splash has restricted the use of the ship for certain things. So even though Splash has kept that sort of restrictions, it is just a change of scope. AFC still can direct the use of the ship. So they might not be carrying explosives, but they might be carrying something else. So they still have the directing rights. So that is very important. And the lessor does not have the right to substitute the identifiable assets. That's very important. Even in the Coffee Beans case, the airport manager had the right to substitute. That's why it's not a lease. Whereas in this case, it does not have the right, so it is a lease. So let's look at lessee accounting. So when we are looking at lessee accounting, so what we need to be careful is that how do we record the right of use assets that we've been saying it, and then what happens, what goes on the credit side. So on the debit side, you record right of use assets. On the credit side, you record lease liability. So what are the initial measurement? So how do we recognize it initially? So for a lease liability, it is the present value of payment, okay? So it is the future value will be brought to present value of the liability, and it also includes fixed payment, whatever the amount that we've done the lease for, whether there might be variable payment which could be based upon index or rate. So some of them might be based upon the profit rate maybe. So they might be saying like, okay, give me your rent based upon your profit. Or otherwise, index could be consumer price index, something like that. And then the amount payable under the residual value guarantee. So the owner says that, okay, you use this particular vehicle, but at the end of that period, I need 100,000 as a residual value. So that will be also included in the liability, which is brought to present value and initially recognized. Okay, at initial recognition, it will include this, all these things. Okay, and then the option to purchase the assets that are reasonably certain to be exercised. So suppose if we were to purchase that particular machinery or land or whatever the asset is, then we need to add that thing up as well. We need to add that amount as well in our liability, okay? And then termination penalties. So if the lease term reflects that the expectations, that this will be incurred, okay? So some of them might have like some clause in the contract. They might say, okay, if you terminate it earlier than this period, then you might have to pay this much amount of fines. So if it is likely that we won't stay in that particular place or we won't use that particular assets for this much period of time, then we might have to include, we must include the amount, which is the termination penalty, in our liability when we are doing our initial measurement. Okay, so all these things are incorporated within the initial measurement amount, so that amount reflects all these things. So it is very important that we need to consider all these things, whether we have this, all these things considered when we are actually determining the present value of payment. Okay, so this is very important. And then after that, when you are recognizing right of use assets, so it is actually measured at cost initially. It's always at cost, right of use assets. And then after that, so what is the cost? It is same, the liability. So it is the amount of initial measurement. So what is the amount of initial measurement? That is of course the liability, present value of liability, right? And then it will be also another lease payment made at or before commencement date. So that will also be included in our right of use assets, okay? And then any direct cost, so there might be some direct cost associated with it, so that is also included in right of use assets. And then estimated cost of removing or dismantling. So suppose there is huge warehouse, so we have to break it down at the end of the period, so that cost will also be incorporated. See, as in IS 16 as per PPE, we used to include that dismantling cost as well. So it is same thing, same as that cost, okay? So all these costs are incorporated when we are initially recognizing a right of use assets, okay? So the amount that we actually record is included of this. So it should be, all these things should be added up, and then only the amount should be recognized, okay? So that's very important thing. So another important thing will be lease term. So it will be mentioned in the contract itself, but still there are a few things that we might need to be very careful. So what are the non-cancelable periods? Because if it has few non-cancelable periods, then that might affect our initial measurement of the liability, because we have to record the termination penalty as well. So that might be influenced by this particular clause. And then the periods covered by an option to extend the lease if reasonably certain to be exercised. So suppose there is an option that we entered into a contract for 3 years, and there is an option to extend for further 1 year. So if it is likely that we will actually exercise that option, then our lease term will be 4 years, whereas if it is not certain that we want to exercise it, it will be 3 years, okay? So that's very important, because based upon that lease period, so we'll be calculating our liability as well, and then we'll be depreciating our assets based on that as well. So another thing that we need to consider when we are determining the lease term is periods covered by an option to terminate the lease if reasonably certain not to be exercised, okay? It is very, very essential. Thus, it is very essential that we actually determine when we are terminating it, because that will be our lease term, right? So that will affect the whole calculations itself. So depreciation will be affected, the initial measurement will be affected, so everything will be affected based on the lease terms, the criteria as well. So even if this is not considered, then everything will be messed up, or everything, even the values that we recognized earlier is not the true value. Okay, so let's look at subsequent measurement. Before that, let's look at a TYU, which will give us a bit of idea about all these concepts. So that will definitely help us like understand all this basic knowledge. So let's look at it. Okay, in this particular TYU, in case of dynamic, what we have done is that, so how do we get the value for our right of use assets? What are the things that I said that we must include? We must include the initial liability, and then after that, we must also include the direct cost associated with it, and then initial payment or subsequent payments, and then after that, any reimbursement should be deducted. Okay, so those are the amounts that are included within the right of use assets. So in this case, what we have done is that we have discounted the number of cash that we are receiving. Okay, so we are paying, so and we are the company who are leasing, so we are the lessee, so we are paying to lessor. So how much are we paying them? In the first year, we are paying them 10,000. In the second year, we are paying them 10,000. In the third year, we are paying them 15,000. So if we are discounting all these values to present value, then our lease liability will be 31,551. So this is our liability. So our right of use assets initially would be this. So that's why what entry did I do? Debit right of use assets, credit lease liability. So corresponding would be lease liability. And then after that, the question also mentions that we incur a direct expense of 3,000, right? So in that case, what we have to do is that we have to recognize that as well as a asset. And then after that, one more thing that I missed was, if there are any dismantling cost, if there would have been any dismantling cost given to us in question, that would also be incorporated or included within right of use assets. So since we are not given that particular figure, so we assume it is zero, so we don't have to make a transaction for that, but we have direct cost, which is 3,000. So for that, what I did an entry was, so debit right of use assets, credit cash, because you are paying cash, so that is also included within right of use assets. And then after that, the question still says that further on, it goes on saying that the lessor has reimbursed 1,000 rupees. So if that particular lessor has reimbursed 1,000, so what do? We reduce that from right of use assets by the same amount that they have reimbursed. Okay, so that's the third entry that I did. So this is first, this is second, this is the third entry, okay? So what is our carrying amount? So if you were to look at the carrying amount, so our right of use assets would be initial liability, which is 31,551. How did we get this amount? We got this amount by discounting the payments that we were supposed to make in after 1 year, after the end of second period, and after the third year, at the end of the third year. Yeah, so that's your lease liability. So you're discounting that figure by market rate of interest. So, and this would be your initial recognition. So this is just your initial recognition. There would be some subsequent recognition as well, but this is your initial recognition. And then the carrying amount of right of use assets is, initial liability is 31,551. And then the direct cost incurred while doing this contract was 3,000. So that is also included within the right of use assets. And then 1,000 was reimbursed by the lessor to lessee. So we have deducted it. So our carrying amount of right of use assets at initial measurement would be 33,551, and then in subsequent measurement what we would have to do is that, so this is our liability, so this is at the start of the year, so at the end of the year, by the time when we have reached the end of the year, we would have to basically include the finance cost, so because the time value of the money would be different by that time. So since our rate is 5%, so what we will have to do is that 31,551 into 5%, 1578. Would be added. So this is the entry that you would make in subsequent measurement. At the end of the year, you would make this kind of entry: debit finance cost, credit lease liability. You would increase the lease liability by its finance cost amount. So the amount that was 31,551 at the beginning of the year, after it has been after the time value has been apportioned, and then after that this will be 1578 would be added to this figure, and then this figure will be whatever comes from here after you've added the both. And then after that you would also have to make another entry, because at the end of the year you are making a payment, right? So will you make a payment of 10,000 or you will make a payment of 20,000? No, we are only making a payment of 10,000, so we debit lease liability by 10,000, because our liability has decreased by that time because we have paid the cash. Okay, so our 10,000 has been reduced. So let's look at subsequent measurement. So I just gave you a little bit of example, even though the question hasn't asked you what could be the subsequent measurement, but I've just given you an example. Let's look at subsequent measurement, so how it is measured and what happens in case of depreciation and in measurement, so remeasurement. So if it is classified under PPE or IS 16 or IS 40, so how would you account for it? So we'll talk about that. So in case of subsequent measurement, what we need to be careful about is that the lease liability will be credited by the finance amount, right? So we debit the finance cost and then we credit the lease liability because it is the time value of money. And then after that, what we have to do another entry as well is about the lease payment. So if when the lease is paid out, so we do debit lease liability, credit cash, because the cash has gone out from the entity. So that's the important thing in case of liability. And what happens in case of right of use assets? So in case of right of use assets, there would be, usually it is measured at cost model. If it is measured at cost model, let's say it would be initial cost less depreciation and impairment. So that would be our subsequent measurement. So how do we determine the depreciation? In that depreciation, how do we determine how many useful years of life have we got on that particular assets? So in while determining the depreciation, what we need to think about is we need to think from two angles. So one is whether the ownership will be transferred or the ownership won't be transferred. So if it is being transferred, then we can depreciate it over the useful life of the assets itself. So the whole life could be considered when actually calculating the depreciation amount. Whereas if the ownership is not being transferred, then we calculate the remaining useful life by using this method, this particular chart. So we do what we normally consider is we consider shorter of useful life and lease term, so whichever is shorter. So why do you think we have done that? Because we are either using it for a short period of time when the life is greater, or we are using the asset for longer than its life period, right? Because we might have actually done the lease agreement at the middle of the period, so we might be the one which is using it for longer than its actual useful life. So that's the another thing that we need to be considering when we are calculating depreciation amount. So again, what we need to be careful about is in this case, in case of right of use assets. So right of use assets, if it is measured under fair value. So when will it be measured under fair value? So under that, we have to determine two conditions. So is it an investment property? So does that right of use of assets meets the definition of investment property? So what happens is sometimes we do a lease agreement with somebody else, and then what we do is we sublease it to somebody else. So now we are the lessor. So we if our the particular assets meets the definition of investment property, which in this case has met, so it can be measured through fair value. Okay, so if it meets the definition of investment property, okay, so any gains or losses will be directly charged to PL in case of investment property, whereas in case of PPE, it's always the other thing, right? So in some leases cases that might happen. And again, in case of IAS 16 PPE, so when can we use IAS 16 PPE for a right of use assets? When it is of same class. Okay, if that particular asset, suppose we leased a particular machinery for a factory, so that factory has the same kind of assets, same class of assets like the other machinery, so it is of same class, right? So the IFRS says that if we are misusing a cost model for the class of assets, then entire class of assets should be measured using cost model. Whereas if the other class is measured using fair value, then we also have to measure this right of use assets as per fair value. Okay, so if the leased assets is of the existing assets same class, then we will have to use fair value model. So that's the most important thing. And then the other thing that we always need to consider is while taking out the depreciation. So if the ownership is being transferred, we use the whole life. If the ownership is not being transferred, then we do a shorter of useful life and lease term, whichever is shorter. And then in case of other measurement model, what we do, we can classify it as per investment property, or we can use fair value model if it meets the definition of IAS 40. So when can that happen? So you might ask examples. So suppose we leased a particular building and then we rent out a particular floor to somebody else. We have subleased it. So we are the lessor now, and then that meets the definition of investment property. So we can use fair value model, okay? So in case of PPE, suppose we have leased a particular machine and then we have that similar sort of machine because we did not have the fund to buy a machine, so we have leased it, okay? So this particular asset class of assets is within the same, these two assets are within the same class. So if this particular machine that we have already is being measured at fair value, then the other machine that we've just leased can also be measured under fair value model. Okay, so that's very important. So, and that's the main gist of this particular subsequent measurement kind of problems. So let's look at something that we identify which model we are using, and then whether it meets the definition of investment property, or whether we already have that same sort of class of assets already, and then if we are measuring that using fair value model, then we can't use cost model for right of use assets because we already have the same class of assets which is being measured at fair value model. Okay, so that's very important. And then the depreciation part, that's pretty much it. Now let's look at componentization. So for a separate component, how we account for that, let's look at it. While allocating this separate component, what we need to be careful about is whether the contract contains a lease liability and a non-lease component or not. Okay, so we need to first of all, identify whether it contains lease and non-lease. And then if the entity specifies, then we will look accordingly. Otherwise, normally it would be allocated based upon the standalone selling price. So the entity chooses consideration based upon standalone selling price. When the entity does not choose, we use standalone selling price. If the entity specifies, then we will use the whatever is given in the question. So this is also lease and non-lease. So it will be considered as a single lease. And then decision for each class of right of use assets. Okay. So every class will be for each class of assets. And then this might also lead to increase in lease liability because so remember when we are buying a bulk item or two items mixed together, the cost price will be less, right? So suppose you are leasing a particular machinery and then the maintenance is, let's say, 50,000, and then the maintenance is 10,000. But if the particular lease has only a payment of 50,000, then we are getting a discount, right? Whereas if we were to pay it separately, for machinery separately, maintenance separately from our own pocket, then it would cost us more, right? Whereas in case of lease only, it will cost less. So that's why it says it will lead to increase in lease liability. So what will happen is that it could give a negative perceptions of the entity towards the potential investors, potential and existing investors, creditors, lenders. Okay, let's look at QIU illustration one, Swiss. So in this case, what has happened is that Swiss has entered into a contract to rent a crane for 3 years. So 3 years is the period, and then the total contract cost is 180,000, and then the payment at end of each year is 60,000, right? So whereas in this case we are actually assessing how to apportionate the lease based upon its standalone selling price. So what is the standalone selling price of crane itself? Only the crane itself is 160,000, and then the maintenance would cost 40,000, whereas in this case what has happened is that we have done a contract of 180,000. So we are saving 20,000 in 3 years period, right? Because we are not paying much for both this component, because we are buying it together. So we are entering into a contract together, so our cost has gone down. So we need to apportionate it. So how much did we pay for the lease? How much did we pay for the non-lease or the maintenance? So in this case, we are only paying 60,000 at the end of the year. So how much percentage of that would be towards lease? How much would be towards non-lease, right? So how do we know that? We know that by the percentage of lease within its total selling price, right? So if these two were selling, it is selling at 160 plus 40. So how much is the ratio of lease of crane by itself on the total selling price? And then how much is the maintenance selling price on the total selling price? So when we calculated the proportionate method, when we proportionate it towards its cost, what we got was 80% was towards lease, and then 20% was towards non-lease, right? So in this 60,000, the payment that we are making, we are also paying 80% towards lease, 20% towards non-lease for maintenance. So 80% of 60,000 would be 48,000. So 40% of, or 20% of 60,000 would be 12,000, right? So we are paying 48,000 every year just for lease. So the remaining 12,000 is for maintenance. Okay. So we need to make a table as such where we have discounted the payment. So 48,000 is our annual payment for 3 years, discounted by 5%, right? So then we get the present value as such, and then the total value is 130,000 and 715, right? So that's our total present value, or what you could say is that that's our initial lease liability. So since we don't have any other variable consideration or anything else given in the question, so that's not included. Otherwise, if it would have been there, then we would also have to include that. Remember, we did that earlier. I think we included a lot of things in this lease liability as well, and then in right of use assets also we included a lot of items. So if you missed that, please rewind it, and then you can definitely have a look at it. Then the initial recognition, what you will actually recognize is only debit right of use assets and credit lease liability. So since we don't have any other direct cost associated with it, so we don't need to capitalize it. So there is only one initial recognition entry, which is debit right of use assets, credit lease liability. So that's the same amount as such. And then in subsequent resume, what do we need to do? We need to charge finance cost. The first thing that comes is finance cost. So for that, what we need to create, what we need to make is lease liability table. So our opening balance is 130,000, and then the interest on that is 6536, and then the payment is 48,000, and then we get our closing balance, right? So this particular interest amount is the amount by which the lease liability should be increased. So debit finance cost, credit lease liability by that particular amount, so by interest amount, right? And then the other entry that we need to make is that this particular entry, which is 48,000 payment. So we actually made a payment of 60,000, but 48,000 is towards lease. So this is our entry, debit lease liability, credit cash, because our lease liability has decreased since we have made a payment, right? And then the 12,000 entry would be over there, debit PL, credit cash, because we are making a payment of 60,000. So we have made 48,000 towards lease, 12,000 towards maintenance. And then the another entry that we should not miss is that there is a depreciation as well, because it is right of use assets and depreciation is charged, right? So if the depreciation, so how we calculate depreciation? If there is an option to purchase, then we charge it over the rest of the life. Whereas if it is not purchased, then what we need to do is that we need to allocate it based upon shorter of the lease term or the life of assets. Okay, shorter of, and then yeah. So you charge depreciation as well, and then after that, how do we present this thing? Is that the difference between these two is your current liability, and then after that, that figure is your non-current liability, right? So yeah, that's pretty much it. When we are reassessing the lease liability, what happens is that the lease payment affects the lease liability, right? So because if you're making the payment at the beginning, you don't have to pay an interest on that, so that amount will definitely make a difference. But what we need to remember is that IFRS 16 particularly says that it should be recalculated using revised discount rate. Revised discount rate. If the lease term changes or the entity's option to purchase, option to purchase the underlying asset changes. Okay, so earlier on it was unlikely that we would purchase the underlying asset, whereas now we have changed the assessment because it seems profitable enough to purchase that particular underlying asset. Okay, so if these two circumstances exist, then it should be calculated, or the lease liability should be recalculated using the revised discount rate. So for the particular revised discount rate, what is it? So it is, if it can be determined, then it is the interest rate, which is implicit for the remaining lease term. And then if it can't be determined, then what should we use? We will use the lessee's incremental borrowing rate at the date of assessment, not at the beginning of the lease or the end of the lease, but at the date of reassessment. Okay. So what we need to remember is that the revised discount rate for the changes in lease term or the entity's assessment for options. Okay. So these two will be happening, and then after that, the revised discount rate would be, if it can be determined properly, yes, then interest rate that is implicit for the next lease term, for the remaining lease term. If you can't determine it properly, then it is the lessee's incremental borrowing rate. So let's look at a problem QIU5 about Kingfisher that should give us a bit of clarity. Let's look at QIU number 5, Kingfisher. So what the question particularly says is that Kingfisher, of company which enters into a 4-year contract for leasing a property, and then the annual payment would be 1 million paid at the first of the year, okay, first day of the year, and then the lease payment would be based upon CPI for preceding 12 months. So it would be, it would increase or it would change, you could say, based upon the CPI index. Okay, so at the beginning it was 125, at the end it was 140. So at the end of the first year it was 140. So the changes that would change our lease liability amount as well, and then after that our IRR would be 5%. Okay, so what would actually happen is that when you're making the first payment, so in the initial recognition itself, what you would earlier do was that you would have to debit right of use assets, credit lease liability, whereas in this case what you would do is that you would pay the amount in the beginning. In the initial recognition itself, you would do debit right of use assets of 1 million, and then you would credit cash by 1 million, and then you would calculate the remaining payments total value. Okay. Otherwise, what you could do as well is that you could write this amount plus this amount. Is your total right of use assets, credit lease liability, credit cash 1 million. You could do that as well, but I have separated it so it will be easier. And then your payment for the first, for the second year's first day is, on the first day of your second year, you would pay 1 million, and then on third year, you would pay 1 million, on fourth year, you would pay 1 million, discounted by 5%. And then you would get this value. So your present value is 2.72, okay? So 2.72 is your lease liability currently. So since your actual assets worth how much? 2.72 plus 1 million. So you've already paid 1 million, so you can reduce that amount. Then after that, but it has not gone from this right of use assets, it's still there. Okay, and then after that, when calculating your depreciation, so after that, what you would do is that debit right of use assets 2.72, and then credit lease liability 2.72, same as the other one where we used to pay at the end of the period. And then for calculating your depreciation, what you would need to do is that your total assets divided by 4, your total assets is 2.72 plus 1 million, which you had already paid earlier. Because your total assets is still 3.72, right? And then you will get a depreciation of 0.93, okay? So since you've got a depreciation as well, and then what you would have to do, you would have to charge the finance cost, right? So for this particular lease liability, what I did was 5% of it would give us the finance cost of this particular amount. So that would increase our lease liability by 0.14, or the rate of interest. And then the question also asks us, how should we record in the second year? So what will happen in second year? So as we have talked that it is based upon the lease liability would be, or the lease payment, you could say. the cash payment would be determined by the consumer price index. So in second year, what had happened was by the year end, the price index had moved up to 140. So it was earlier, how much? 125. So what's the factor by which it has been increased, right? So since when we are making a payment, we used to make 1 million payment. But now what has happened is that due to the change in consumer price index, our payment would be 1.12, right? So during the second year, what I have done is that I have still made a cash present value stable. And then after that, what I have done is that on the first date, we have made a payment of 1.12. The discounting factor is 1. Why? You could say why? Because we are at the same date, so we don't need to discount it, right? So even though if you do it, 1 divided by 1, 1.05 to the power 0, right? So that would not give us anything. So that would be 1.12 because it is not discounted, because we are already on the same particular day. And then what you would get is that 3.21 is your lease liability. So earlier on, we have already reported on right of use assets as well, and then a lease liability as well. So now what we need to do is that just increase that particular amount by the change of that particular price index change, because this amount of lease liability change has come because of the change in price index, right? So what we will do is that this lease liability minus this will give us your the amount that we need to increase the particular assets and the lease liability. Okay, so we have remeasured it again, so there has been an additional payment, or there should be an additional lease liability of 0.35. okay, and then after that, when you make the payment, what you would do, debit lease liability by 1.12, credit cash, right? And then your carrying amount of right of use assets is, so what's the carrying amount left in here? Because why would you need the carrying amount? Because you would have to calculate depreciation, right? So you would have to depreciate the particular asset as well. So what I have done is that 3.72 was your right of use assets as from earlier on. 2.72 plus 1 million. This plus this minus your depreciation, so that's the sum of this two amount. That's your carrying amount at the beginning, and then after the depreciation, it's 2.79, and then the amount has increased by 0.35, right? Let's check it some another way as well. Let's check 0.3.21 minus 0.93. 2.28, right? Let's do it another way. 3.12 plus 3.21 plus 1, 4.21. 3.72 plus 0.33, 4.07. Minus 0.93, that will give us the same value as well. Okay, so what you could do is that it's the same thing, you know, you can calculate it by any method that you like. It really doesn't make any kind of difference. So you could add that amount plus this amount minus your depreciation, you will get the same amount. Or what you could do is that you have already calculated your right of use assets, it's already over here, and then you just bring that figure, subtract your depreciation, you will get your carrying amount at the year end, and then the increment amount on that was 0.35, so change it by that particular amount, so you would basically get the same figure again. IFRS 16 also presents us that if it is a short term or if it is of low value, then we can apply simplified treatment. Okay, so what this particular IFRS says is that it does not specify or gives us the monetary value for low value item. It does not say like, okay, below 500 is low value item, but it gives us examples like tablets, small personal computers, telephone, and then small items of furniture. Okay, so if these are the items that that you are leasing, then it is treated as low value item, okay? And then whereas if suppose you say a car or let's say a laptop, so laptop falls under that, so a personal computer, right? So laptop falls under that. And then after that, you can use a simplified treatment, which is you don't have to recognize any right of use assets. It's only liability, okay? So you, whatever you do is that if you make a payment at the year of the, at the year end or at the beginning, you just expense it via your SOPL. So you don't have to basically show right of use assets or lease liability. So in case of short life items, so it is less than 12 months. So in case of items which are leased for less than 12 months, a simplified treatment is allowed as per IFRS 16, okay? And then no monetary value has been mentioned in the standards. It has only given us examples of these four items, which is tablets, small computers, and then small pieces of furniture, and then telephone. And then when you are assessing the low value item, what you need to be careful about is that since we don't know the monetary value, so if it does not fall under this category, then what we will need to do is that we would have to see what would be the new value. Or when you're making the assessment of the asset, so if you are purchasing an old car and then you say it's a low value item, you can't say that, because you still need to recognize it as a right of use assets, because its value when it is new is higher, right? It's not a low value item when it is new. See, because it has been used for multiple of years, that's why its value has gone down. Otherwise, so when you're making the assessment, you would have to make the assessment what would be its purchasing price, or when you are buying it at new, or what would be the value at when it is new. That would be a basis of assessment. Okay, so based upon that, you will have to classify it as right of use assets or not a right of use assets if it falls under low value item. Okay, so since no monetary value has been given, so only these four items are treated as low value item. And then your lessee disclosures. So what kind of disclosures are you required to make? So first thing is that you would have to show right of use assets in your asset side. So it is not treated as separately, okay? It is not shown separately. It is shown within the asset section itself, within non-current assets, okay? Or yeah, within, you can say, non-current assets itself. And then after that, this thing, it is also treated as if it is owned by you, okay? So if it were owned by you, how would you treat it? You would actually treat it under PPE or whatever you would treat it under. So you would keep it same as that, okay? And then disclosing amount. So what kind of disclosures do you need to make? You need to make the depreciation amount charged on it. That should be your disclosures. Interest expense on your lease liability. Expenses relating to short-term lease and low value item. Where will this amount be seen? It will be seen in SOPL, okay? And then cash outflows for leased assets. So how much cash outflow you have allocated for the lease payment. And then right of use assets addition. So what kind of right of use assets has been added during the year? That should also be disclosed. Or how much is the amount of added right of use assets? And then your carrying amount of right of use assets, which is depreciation minus your right of use assets minus your depreciation. Or if you have already made an initial payment, then you would have to make the initial payment plus your lease liability and then your depreciation. So that will be your carrying amount. And then if you also have to do a maturity analysis of your lease liability, so that will give us, that will give the investors a knowledge when that particular lease is expiring and they can make their particular decisions. Okay, so for F7 you only have to cover or deal this much, whereas in case of SVR we also need to study lessor accounting. So let's look at lessor accounting and let's see what it says and then whether it allows us finance and operating classification or not. Let's discuss about it. In case of SPR, what we need to do is that we only in F7, what we used to do was we used to only account for lessee accounting, right? Whereas in SPR, we still must account for lessor accounting, and then this is done the old way. Okay, since this new IFRS 16 has come, it has only changed the provision for lessee accounting, whereas for lessor accounting it's particularly same as the old one. Okay, so in lessor accounting there is still a provision that you can classify a lease as finance lease and operating lease. So what is finance lease? So finance lease is where the risk and reward is transferred. Okay, so substantially all the risk and reward of underlying asset is transferred to lessee, then it is considered as finance lease. Whereas in case of operating lease, a lease that does not meet the definition of finance lease, whereas what this particularly means is that the risk and reward is still with the lessor, that's why it is operating lease. Okay, and then how to classify? So how do we classify finance lease? So so when will you actually say that the substantial all risk and rewards has been transferred? When? So there are a few criteria that this IFRS has given us. So if one or more of the following apply, so all these criteria, if one or more of these criteria apply, then we can classify it as a finance lease. Okay, so in this particular case, so if the ownership is transferred at the end of the period to the lessee, then we can classify it as finance lease, but it should meet one or more criteria. Okay, and then the next criteria is the lessee has the option to purchase the assets for less than its expected fair value at the date of the option becomes exercisable, and it is reasonably certain that the option will be exercised. So the lessee has a lessor has given a chance to the lessee that they can purchase the particular asset, or he or she has the, or the entity has the option to purchase it at a fair value, okay, less than its expected fair value. Okay, so they are more likely to be exercisable. So if there is that condition, then it is classified as finance lease. And then the lease term, if the major part of the economic life of the particular asset is being used by the lessee, then it is also transferred, it is also considered as finance lease, or it could be a criteria for considering as a finance lease. Okay, so three things: ownership transferred at the end, and then there is your option which is for less than its fair value, and then after that the economic life, the third criteria, the fourth criteria being the present value of lease payments to substantially all the fair value of leased assets. So at inception, so suppose there is a condition within the contract that says you have to pay this particular amount at front, and if that particular amount is substantially all the fair value of the leased assets, then it is considered as finance lease. Okay, so that's your fourth. And then your fifth is the leased assets are of specialized nature, and then the lessee can use them without major modification. So lessee can only use it with can use them without major modification. Okay, so it's of specialized nature, then also it's considered as finance lease. And then the lease will compensate the lessor for their losses if the lease is cancelled. Okay, so suppose we had an agreement of 4 years, and then it has a clause as well. So suppose you there was a provision for maintenance or something, and then something else happened, or like the maintenance wasn't good, or it did not satisfy the lessee, then there is a provision that they can cancel it, and then when they cancel it, they have to pay a certain amount. So if the lessor is compensated for the cancelled amount, that also it is considered as finance lease. Okay, and then gains or losses from fluctuations in fair value of residual fall to lessee. So if the fair value gain or losses of fair value is compensated by the lessee, then also it is considered as finance lease, because they have to pay the money, so the risk is with them, right? Same as in Europe as well. So since the lessee has to compensate for the lessor, if the lessee lease is cancelled, so the risk is with them. So that's why it is considered as finance lease. And then the last is lease can continue. The lessee can continue the lease for secondary period in exchange for substantially lower than the market rate. So suppose you have already stayed in this particular place, or you have rented this particular asset, or like you are living in that particular place, the lessor might say, okay, I don't want to replace you with somebody else, so I just give it to you for a lesser price. So if that is there, then that is also considered as finance lease. Okay, so they must fulfill one or more criteria. So as it says, one or more of the following. If it just fulfills one or two items, so it will be pretty much given in the question as well, whether like you can classify it as lease or not. So let's look at one particular question which would give us a bit of clarity. So the question we are looking at is TYU6. So what this particular question says is that Dan Bob is a lessor and he is drawing up a lease agreement for a building. So the building has a remaining useful life of 50 years, and then the commencement date is 1st January 2000. It's for 30 years, okay? So Dan Bob would receive 40% of the assets value upfront from the lease. At the end of each of the 30 years, Dan Bob would receive 6% of the assets fair value as at 1st January 2000. The legal title at the end of the lease remains with Dan Bob, so it's with the lessor itself, but the lessee can continue to lease the assets indefinitely at a rental that is substantially below the market value. If the lessee cancels the lease, it must make a payment to Dan Bob to recover its remaining investment. So let's look at it. So since Dan Bob is a lessor and then it is drawing up a lease agreement, so the building has a remaining useful life of 50 years, and then so the company is particularly using it for 30 years, right? So basically the lease term, so a major part of its economic life, which is you could say like 60%, is particularly used by the Dan Bob, but it also has an option to extend it at a lower market price, as it says. And then what is also said is that it receives 40% of this particular payment. So it's not substantially all the fair value, but it still receives 40% plus 6% of the fair value as at the inception date. Okay, so they will be basically the risk will be basically with lessee. Okay, and then after that, can continue to lease the asset indefinitely at a rental that is substantially lower. So they can particularly say, like say, okay, I want to lease for the next 100 years, so it's indefinite. So if they are like, if they have option like that to actually fix the term of the lease, and also they are getting it at a lower price than the other, so they will have a competitive advantage. So they will exercise it, right? So they will actually enter into a new lease agreement. So it is considered as finance lease. Okay, so let's look at finance lease, how it is treated, and then after that let's look at some problems that should give us a bit of clarity. So in case of finance lease, how is it presented in our financial statement? Initially, when finance lease is recognized, what will we recognize is that receivable. So that will be the lease liability in case of lessee, and then it would be a receivable of finance lease. Okay, so this is also treated as per IFRS 9. Okay, financial assets. It is a financial asset as well. And then after that, what will that receivable particularly include is that the fixed number of payment for the particular asset they are actually leasing from us, and then the variable payment. So what would be the variable payment, such as based upon index or something else. And then after that, residual value guarantee will also be included in the receivable, and then unguaranteed residual value as well, or guaranteed you could say. And then after that, purchase option that are certain to be exercised. Okay, so option that have that is certain to be exercised. Termination penalties, if the lease term reflects the expectation that these will be incurred. So same as in case of lessee, whatever the but the figures, whatever the all these figures that would have been incorporated within the lease liability is also incorporated within the residual. So basically the initial remuneration would be same. Okay, so in case of lessee, they record all these things, debit right of lease assets and credit lease liability, whereas in case of lessor, what would you do? You would debit your receivable. Okay, and then after that, so in case of subsequent treatment, what will you do is that, so in what does the lessee does, he or the entity, they normally increase the lease liability by charging a finance cost, right? Whereas in case of this, it is the receivable amount is changed by the finance income at the year end. So it is also credited to SOPL, right? So debit receivable increased by the finance amount and then credit SOPL. And then the credit, the carrying amount of receivable would also decrease with the cash payment, because once it is received, you won't be paid twice. Okay. So with every cash receipts, our receivable will decrease. And then in case of operating lease, so where the risk and reward is within the lessor himself. So we'll treat the recognized income over lease term. Okay, over the lease term. And then it is simplified treatment. And then after that, it is just recognized as an income in your SOPL. That's pretty much it. And then you would also have to charge any direct cost associated with the lease to the underlying asset. Okay, so while you are negotiating that particular lease, there might be some direct cost associated with it. For a lessor, then you would also have to remember, we did a problem where we were reimbursing 1000, so that would be added in our underlying assets in this case. For depreciation, you should do as according to IAS 16 PPE or IAS 38 intangible assets. Okay, so based upon this, you will have to charge your depreciation. Whatever these two particular standards says, do as per it. And then for your disclosures, in case of finance, what you will have to do is that finance lease is, you have to show the profit or loss on sale when there is an option to purchase for the lessee, and then when there is a sale, right? So you have to charge the profit or loss. And then your finance income must be also disclosed, which is normally the amount by which our receivable increases at the year end. So changes in carrying amount of lease. So what is the changes in the carrying amount of lease? So suppose if there was a variable payment, so that changes within 1 year because of an index. So that changes our particular carrying amount of lease, whether it might increase or it might decrease. So that is also, that should also be disclosed properly. And then maturity analysis of lease receivables. So whatever the receivables are, we will also have to do a maturity analysis. Okay, so in case of operating lease as well, so normally the disclosures would be basically the income recognized, that is also our disclosure, the amount, and then the maturity analysis of undiscounted lease payment receivable. So it is not discounted, but in this case the carrying amount of lease is discounted amount, whereas in case of operating lease, it isn't a discounted amount. Okay, that's very important distinction that they have within disclosures for both this thing. So now let's look at lease and lease back, and then let's see how when a transfer is a sale or not a sale, and then how will that affect our treatment, or how will it present in our SOFP. Let's look at that. So in case of lease sale and lease back, what we need to be careful about is that the seller is the lessee as well, because the seller leases back, right? So suppose A sells some asset to B, then A is the seller, B is the buyer. And then again, when A leases from B, A is the lessee, B is the lessor, right? So this particular has to use lessee accounting, right? And then, so what happens is during this case, what we need to be careful about is we need to use IFRS 15. So we need to determine whether the sale has happened or not. So as per IFRS 15, when the performance obligation is satisfied and the control of the asset has been transferred, then only it is considered as sale, right? So if the sale isn't, if a transfer isn't a sale, then what will happen? That means the buyer, this B entity, will not have the control over the asset. So it cannot recognize asset as well. And then it will recognize financial asset for the proceeds that they have transferred, okay? Whereas in case of seller, what they will do is that they will recognize the transferred assets. It will still be recognized. It cannot de-recognize, okay? And then it will be treated as financial liability. So in simple terms, what you can say is that the amount that we've received is treated as a loan, okay? So if it isn't a sale, then it's pretty simple. And then in this case, you might say like, okay, so suppose A is the seller and B is the buyer, and then there hasn't been any sale, right? So you cannot recognize any asset, neither can you. Neither this entity has the control, okay? So if it isn't a sale, all you need to remember is that the asset is still recognized by seller, and then B doesn't recognize, the purchaser doesn't recognize the asset, and then any proceeds that they have given to the seller is a finance cost, finance liability, okay? And then in case of, if a transfer is a sale, then in this case, what happens is that the buyer will use lessor accounting. So suppose if the risk and reward is with the seller, so if it is with the lessor, then they might classify that as a finance lease, or like, if it is with entity A, they might classify it as a finance lease. If it is with this entity itself, then it may classify it as a operating lease, right? But still, we do have to go through our conditions, whether the major economic life is being used by the lessee or not. And then after that, we have other criteria as well, such as whether the lessee has the option to renew it at a lower market price or not, and then after that, whether there is an option to purchase or not, and then whether the gain or loss on fair value will be bearded by this particular lessee or not, and then after that, anything to do with risk and reward is basically with the lessee, then it is considered as finance lease, right? So in case of seller, what they will normally do is that they will now have to de-recognize the particular asset, right? So they have to recognize right of use assets. So how much will they recognize right of use assets is as the proportion of previous carrying amount, okay? So what they will normally do is that in this case, so this will be your fair value. And then up will be your lease liability. So the difference is the amount, or like the interest that we have retained is still, there is a retained interest, which is the lease liability, right? Out of the fair value. So proportion of that, and then into carrying amount. So how much is still left? That's what we need to find out, right? So right of use assets is calculated based upon the proportion of previous carrying amount. So how much proportion of this carrying amount is still retained by this seller, okay? So which is how much amount, so which is basically just the amount that is remaining, or which can also be figured out by the lease liability. That is the remaining interest or remaining rights that is retained by the particular seller, Okay, so that's the case. And then if the transaction is not at fair value, or you could say below market terms, which is selling proceeds is less than fair value, then it is considered as prepayment of lease, okay, or prepayment of lease, okay. And then if it is above market terms, then the sales proceed is greater than the fair value, then it is considered as additional financing. Okay, so any amount which is paid above the fair value is additional financing. Any amount which is below the fair value is considered as prepayment of lease. Okay, so that's pretty much it. All you need to be careful about is that in case of if it is not a sale, then it is treated as a loan. And then if it is a sale, then what we need to be careful about is that buyer will apply lessor accounting. They might classify it as finance lease or operating lease based upon the criteria that we've earlier talked about. And then in case of seller, what they will do is that they will have to find out the proportion of previous carrying amount, or like how much they have used and how much is still remaining. You'll have to basically find out how much has been, or how much is the, you'll have to find the proportion of previous carrying amount, which is the rights that they have actually retained for future period, okay, or which the rights they have actually retained. And then if the transaction is above the market value, then it is considered as additional financing. Whereas if you're not receiving the particular fair value, then it is considered as prepayment of lease. Okay, so that's pretty much it, guys. So IFRS 16 is pretty much done. So if you have any other questions, please do comment down below. I'll definitely answer it for you. Until next time, bye bye.